Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Say it to be greeted in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Tell your neighbor, stop.
Stop.
Stop, 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 stop. Hallelujah. I want to do something. I want to say, not sing, absolutely not. Okay, that's one of the things that I'm praying about, and hopefully God will bless me. Hallelujah. So I'm going to say Jesus Christ, this side is going to say, is, I will say Jesus Christ is the same.
Today.
I know not. So, somebody say stop this side.
Stop.
Okay, let me start. Jesus Christ is the same. This side, say so.
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 Okay. I'll start this side. Jesus Christ is the same.
Yes.
Give God a hand of praise. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Just greet your neighbor. Tell them that we are talking about a life that reveals Christ. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, my name is Thais Khosa, and I'm here to talk to you under that theme, Life That Reveals Christ, from the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter number 5, verse number 15. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, I'm just going to pray before I start everything. Let's close our eyes. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus. Lord, be honored even tonight as I'm standing before your children, to proclaim your way, to speak to their hearts, to speak to their spirits, that Father, your Holy Spirit, who has done it before, will do it even today. That Father, you will speak to us, you will give us understanding, you will help us, Lord, to grasp what you have for us tonight. In the mighty name of our Lord Jesus, Father, we stand against any spirit of disturbance in this place. That Father, we will learn, and Father, go out of this place not being the same again. In the name of Jesus, Father, thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
So, since we're talking about a life that reveals Christ, I wonder what's the first thing that came to your mind when you read about this thing. Hallelujah. A life that reveals Christ. Hallelujah. It was Apostle Paul who was talking about himself and the challenges, the struggles that he was going through. And then he ended up saying, if you are in our right mind, it is for you, it is for your benefit. But if we are out of our mind, it is for God. And then we say that We the life that we live should reveal Christ. The life that we live should be lived for Christ, because Christ died for us. Hallelujah. So it is in a reverse way. That's how the kingdom of God works. If the first shall be the last, you die first and live forever. Hallelujah. So it said, for if one man died, all of us died. This is a very mysterious statement. If one man died, we all died. Hallelujah. And really, indeed, one man died, and therefore, we all died. And those who now live should no longer live for themselves, but live for the one who died and rose for their sake. So it was in our place that Jesus Christ died, and then he rose. It was because of us that he died and he rose. Therefore, our life should be lived for the one who died and rose for us. Hallelujah. Can you please give God a hand of praise for that? Hallelujah. So to avoid a hit and run approach, I've decided to not to dig deeper into the theme, but just to lay a foundation where we're gonna base our engagement and our talkings. Hallelujah.
Amen.
From now onwards. So I want to talk about greater love. It's so surprising that when I was preparing this message, I didn't speak to any of the people who were standing in front. One came and talked about John 3:16, the love of God. The one came and talked about God cares so much. Who are we that God will care so much about us? It is the love of God. And I come now, I want to talk to you about greater love. Somebody say greater love. Somebody say greater love. Hallelujah. So one man, I believe it is in this room, came in and gave an analogy and said, what if you had a twin brother or sister who looked like you, and people couldn't differentiate between you and your sister or brother, and then you yourself, your life was so messed up that you did everything wrong. You lived a life, a reckless life, a life that doesn't care about what will happen tomorrow, what will happen to others if I do this. A life, a sinful life. And yet your brother or your sister lives a life that is pleasing both to God and to man. This person is in peace with everyone. He has no sin. But you yourself have everything not in order. And because of that, now the things that you did to other people are now haunting you. So people come looking for you, wanting to kill you because of what you did. You deserve the punishment. They are coming. Remember, you deserve the punishment. They are coming to kill you. And your brother who looks like you, or your sister who looks like you, say, no, my brother, here's a deal. Because I love you so much, I don't want these people to kill you. I know that your life is not together. I have some, most of the thing in control, but your life is so messed up. But because I love you so much, give me your clothes. I'll take your clothes and wear like you and go out. And when these people come, they will find me and kill me on your behalf. It was because of love. Then my question to you then is that if you were to repay to that person, how would you repay them? I mean, this person, they had their degrees, everything, all the kinds of cars you may ever think of. Everything is fine with them. But yourself, everything is not fine. Your life was just opposite. They are like, and they say, let me die on your behalf. How would you repay them? Hallelujah. Is there any amount you would pay to repay them? Hallelujah. Is there any amount of days in fasting or in prayer that you would do to repay them? Hallelujah. So in the same way, if this kind of scenario matters to you, if it would matter to you that your brother or your sister dies dead for you, I want you to listen to me very carefully. Because tonight I'm going to talk about greater love. It's not just a love, it's greater love. Hallelujah. So if we have a difficult to understand the love of Jesus Christ, if we have difficult in understanding the love of God, then we will not see any reason for us to live a life that reveals Jesus Christ. So that's why I chose tonight to talk about the love of God. Because it is in understanding that we are not living a life that reveals Christ because we are so afraid, but because of love. Hallelujah. Those who are, I believe that we are all students, and those who are not students, who were once students. So, you do an assignment because you love the course, or because... And you guys dance at me saying, I'm not going to the wrong place. Okay, let's leave the passing space, ne? In high school, you used to do homework. Now you're fine. In high school, you used to do homework because of either you were afraid of the teacher that they will deal with you.
That was the one
reason. Or you love the subject. N-O. Okay, let's talk about N-O now. Okay. It's either you love the course that you do the homework, or you are afraid that they will punish you. But the kind of life that we are talking about that should reveal Christ, it's not because of fear. It is because of love. Understanding the love that God has for you and I. That's why I said Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. His love is consistent. It's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Whether season changed, we change. Situations come and go. We feel like God doesn't love us. Sometimes we feel like God loves us. Then what we are feeling is not what is true. Amen. So I want you to understand that there is a greater love. Hallelujah. Let's open the book of... Let me read a bit. Let's open the book of John 15, verse number 9 to 13. Hallelujah. Someone's going to read for us. Oh, we can read it together if it's there. 50 years. Yeah, that's it. Let's read together. As the Father has loved me,
I have also loved you. Remain in my love.
Verse number 10. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I kept my Father's commandments and remained in his love. Number 11.
I
have spoken these things to you so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. Number 12.
This is my command. Love one another as I have loved you.
Thank you. Can we please repeat this one? This one needs to be repeated. Yes, 1, 2, 3, go. No one has greater love than this, that someone would lay down his life for his friends. Hallelujah. Give God a hand of praise. God so loved you and I, not by any other kind of love, but this is a godly love. I want to show you something. We have four types. I've just written down four types of love. It may come with 10 or whatever, but these are the four types of love that I think we can better relate. Everyone can relate. Hallelujah. The first one is brother love. I love because you are my brother. Like, the chaplain is my brother. And you are my sister. We love each other. Hallelujah. The second one is family love. I love you because we are one family. Hallelujah. We were born in one family. So that's the second type of love. The third one is partner love. Yes, sorry. I love this
guy.
So you see?
Yeah.
You people. The third one, it's father and mother, they love each other. You understand? Eh? Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Okay, let's go. The fourth one is the one that I want to talk about.
Okay.
This one is what we call the great love that we read about. This is a God kind of love. This love is steadfast. It's greater than all of those three. If you have this one, you will not struggle with the rest. But you can have a brother love and still not have this one. This one is the greater one. Hallelujah. This is the kind of love that you disregard circumstances. This one excludes conditions.
Yeah.
People, we can put conditions when they don't deserve this, but this one protect those who are not protected.
Yeah.
Because it disregards conditions. Hallelujah. And this one, it is the reason why God don't give up on you and I.
Yeah.
Because He loves us. This one is the kind of love that when we sin, God continue to forgive us.
Yeah.
Because how many times have we sinned?
Oh,
but God continues to forgive. It's steadfast. Hallelujah. So that's the kind of love I want to talk about. Hallelujah. The book of John 3:15, this one won't break it. But I don't know. No. Won't break this one. Let's say it together. 1, 2, 3, go. Hallelujah. Clap hands for yourself. Hallelujah. We still talk about greater love. This kind of love is the one that caused Jesus Christ to endure the cross with you and I in His mind. It is the same love that caused Him to come on earth and be in the form of His own creation. Be persecuted, forsaken. Some spit on His face. They crucified. This is what makes me, it get emotional. Because he was crucified by His own creation. Persecuted, create something, and something start. You see, if I create a computer right now and start, I just break it. Hallelujah.
Okay.
But He went all the way even unto the cross because of this kind of love. It was for you and I. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, the book of 2 Corinthians chapter number 9, chapter number 5, verse 21, it says that He was made sin. He was not a sinner.
Yeah.
He was made sin because of you and I. And I'm saying tonight that if we have difficulty in understanding this kind of love, we will see no reason for our life to reveal Him. If we have difficulty, when you wake up in the morning and nothing about His love talks in your mind, you spend your day however you want it. Hallelujah. I make it my aim that every time I wake up in the morning, almost every day, I talk to myself. There's nothing wrong with that?
Yeah.
So, okay. David says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul." Who was David? Who was he talking to you? Amen. So in the same line, I talk to myself, talk to my soul. The sign is God loves you. Whether you feel it or you don't feel it, He loves you. Whether everything is going the way you think it should go or it's going the other way around, God is the same. He's loves you. He loves you in such conditions, He loves you. And when the going gets so hard, and I tell myself, God loves you. Because when I say God loves you, when I tell myself that God loves you, it means a lot to me. If I keep quiet and don't say it, it might, sometimes I might forget. But when I say it, I keep telling myself, God loves you. Yeah, listen to this. I don't wait for someone to come and tell me because I know this is a greater love. I tell myself, God loves you. Says, wake up. I tell, God loves you. You are going through this and that, but God loves you. And it is sinking in my soul. And as I walk, and with all the challenges that I'm facing in life, the good things, the good time, I don't forget that God loves me. Hallelujah. So, with that in mind, I want us to go to the book of, let's go to the verse and book, 2 Corinthians chapter number 5. Now we're going to read verse number 13 and 14. Hallelujah. If God loved us this much, and then what's next? Let's read. Are you there yet? Yes. Amen. Let's go. 1, 2, 3, go. For if we are out of our mind, it is for God. If we have sound mind, it is for you. What? For Christ's love compels. Underline such.
Yeah.
For Christ's love compels us, since we have reached this conclusion, if one died for all, then all died. So I want you to understand where the theme is coming from.
Yeah.
That's why I say, the love that reveals Christ shouldn't be out of fear. It should be out of the very same love that I was describing, that God will come on earth and allow himself to be persecuted and crucified by his own creation. Paul says, I can be afraid that judgment will come. I can be afraid that I can go to hell if I don't do this and this and this. If I don't live a life that is pleasing to God. But he says, I choose to be compelled by Christ's love. It is the love of Christ that compels, that compelled him, that he started living a life that reveals Christ. Hallelujah. Okay, I want to read it in King James Version. Do you have it?
Yes.
Okay, let's go. 1, 2, 3, go. For the love of Christ constrained us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we are all dead. I want you to look at how these different versions use the word compels. King James uses constrained. Amen. So, I'm not sure if you have this one. Okay. New Living Translation? You don't know. Okay, I'll read it. Either way, Christ's love controls us. The love that I was talking to you about, it is the one that constrains. It is the one that controls. It is the one that compels. So the very same love, if I want to take an action that is against God, it is not the fear that pushes me back. It is the love that he has for me that pushes me back. If I want to use a language that is not acceptable, the very same love, it is the one that says, God loved you so much. He did so much. You can't be doing this. There's something much better that you can be saved.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
So it says that when you look at the word constrained, controls and compels. So when you're constraining something, you're trying to limit the freedom of that thing. If you control something, you tell it where to go, where not to go. If I constrain you and say, you shall not use this door to enter or to exit, neither shall you use that door to enter and exit. I'm constraining you, I'm controlling you, I'm telling you what to do. But this time around, it's not because when you go there, you'll be shocked by electricity or you get some punishment. It is because you have been loved so much that the very same love that God has shown you tells you where to go, where not to go. What to say, what not to say. It tells you what are the things that you should engage in and the things that you shouldn't engage in. It is the love. Now we're not talking about fear. People live with God in fear. But I'm showing you the other side. You should be afraid of God as well, because He's God. But I'm talking about the love side of it. Paul says, when he started the book of 2 Corinthians, he says, God, our comforter, because at that time, he needed comfort. In this time, he's God of love because he's showing great love. In other time, he said, fearful, he says, don't tremble before any other man, but tremble before me, your God. Don't fear anything else, but fear me. So he's still the God who can bring fear. But now, he's the God who loves. And now, the love that reveals Christ is no longer driven by fear, but it's driven by love. That's amazing. Give God a hand of praise. Anyway, so let's go to verse number 15 of the very same chapter. 2 Corinthians chapter number 5, verse number 15. Are you still good?
Yes.
Okay, let's go. 1, 2, 3, go. Hallelujah. So, Good News Translation would, at the end, say, was raised to life for their sin. Remember all these things, everything that Jesus did on earth or anywhere, it was for our sake. He had us in His mind. When He said, God, let this cup pass. He remembered that moment. I wasn't here to live. And I wasn't here for myself. And then you immediately came into His mind. And then He changed the statement. Not my will, O Lord, but let your will be done. It was because He had you in His mind. Hallelujah. So now we have looked at the love of God and how it constrains us and how it should control us. So it is because God loved us so much that we live for Him. It is because God has done so much for us that we live for Him. They say, I have 15 minutes. Let me just wrap up. Hallelujah. Okay. There are two or three things that Apostle Paul had when he was writing these things. He was appreciating that he was living in a tent. He says, when we die, we shall be in our building. Check the use of words. I'm in a tent. When I die and leave this tent, I will have my own building from work. So, can we wear the two? A tent and a building. So he says, while you are camping, attention that you are here for it temporarily.
Yeah.
But there's a building that you have. He says, when we are sitting this tent, we should reveal, setting our eyes on the things that are not seen. For the things that are sin are not permanent. So I want you to understand that it is because we are living here on earth, temporary. But just, that's why the world hates you so much. It hated the Lord Jesus Christ. Said, you can't be above your master. The world will hate you. Because we don't belong here. And the life that we live doesn't belong here.
Yeah.
We have our eyes fixed on something else. And the way we walk is directed by what we are looking at. And people wonder, how do these people do this? But we have a source of how we should take the next step. So when Paul says his love constrained us, it is because he was having that in mind. Someone said greater love. Someone said greater love. Hallelujah. God loves you so much. So okay. The unseen. God is spirit. You can't see him, you can't touch him, you can't smell him. But he's still God, he's still present. So it takes someone who treasures what is spiritual. You treasure what is unseen more than what is seen. In that way, you can walk and understand this love and allow your life to reveal Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Let's give God a hand of praise. Amen. So I want to conclude my message tonight by taking you to the book of Colossians chapter number 3, verse number 1. The vision of the calf says bearing witness to the message of his resurrection. Let's go and look at what Paul says about his resurrection as it relates to us. Let's read. 1, 2, 3, go. Hey, your brother can get.
Yeah.
Can you please serve us for? Yeah, bring the other one. Amen. Okay, let's go. 1, 2, 3, go. So, if you have been raised with the Messiah, seek what is above, where the Messiah is seated at the right hand of God. Hallelujah. Okay. So, this is one of the things that Apostle Paul said, that if we want to live a life that reveals Christ. That one. It works. It worked for the apostles. And it's working even today.
Amen.
You were raised with Jesus Christ. So fix your eyes where he is. Hallelujah. And then I want us to look at verse number 5. The same book. Verse number 5. So, these are the things that makes Christ to be unseen in our life. When people look at us, they see no difference between us and them because of this. He said, you've been raised with Jesus Christ. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory and all that. Verse number 5. Therefore, put to death whatever in you, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, greed, which is idolatry. And then he continued to mention a lot of things, anger, forgiveness, and all that. Those things says they make Christ not to be seen in you. Regardless of how you attend church, regardless of how you pray. But if these are still there, people will not see any different. Therefore, the message, because remember, we are Christ's letters. Not letters, we are Christ's letter. Not written on stones, but in our heart. Not by hand, but by the Spirit. So when we are working, people can read. We don't live for people, we live for God, but people can see. And that becomes our sermon. Without you speaking, what is it that people can identify, this one is a child of God? Hallelujah. So I want you to look at something so wonderful. Listen, therefore, put to what? Did he say? Put aside?
Suspend
it. Did he say, just throw it away? Did he say, lock it somewhere? It will come out.